There is only one country in the world where you can see these silhouettes. Australia has chosen as its emblem a very distinctive animal. It's the largest marsupial. The well-known kangaroo. Just a note, however, out of the 60 different species of kangaroos, we will mainly follow the most common one, the red kangaroo. It's easy to understand the amazement of the first explorers when they discovered this creature. A greyhound leaping like a deer or a desert rat, but much bigger, is how James Cook described a kangaroo when he landed on this unknown continent. This creature could come straight out of a medieval book of fantastic beasts with its huge hind, puny chest, short arms, rabbit-like head, and a tail over a meter long which is either used as a prop or as a balance. Kangaroos hop at an average speed of 20 to 25 kilometers per hour, 40 kilometers per hour at top speed, even at 60 over short distances. We are in the arid bush of southern Australia, where temperatures exceed 40 degrees Celsius during the dry season. The red kangaroo has become fully adapted to this environment. Is he feeling too hot? He moistens his forearms by licking them. As the saliva evaporates, the body cools down. Kangaroos can go without drinking for some time as the plants they eat contain 20 to 30% water. But if he smells there's a pool nearby, he will go off track to find it. These water pools, known as billabongs, retain water during the dry season. They are a heaven-sent oasis for the animals living in the bush. Kangaroos often have to put up with noisy neighbors, the little corellas. Corellas love to form large flocks and are very gregarious. At dawn, they settle on a perch which is ideally located for drinking. This young kangaroo has returned to his mother. At two, he is still timid and probably frightened by the noisy baying cockatoos. Male and female corellas are strictly identical. The couples pair for life, and once they focus on their nesting site, they'll stay away from large crowds. Only the immature youngsters keep flying in groups until they find their soulmate. Dawn has made way for full daylight. Kangaroos go back to their moms. Those cranes are like hurrying silhouettes in the sky. This tropical species, the saurus crane, is so elegant with its extraordinary 2.4-meter wingspan. With such a wing surface, the crane can fly at nearly 80 kilometers per hour. It means it would only take them a few days to cover the 3,000 kilometers that separate the arid south from the lush rainforests of Queensland in Western Australia. Is about to enter this emerald setting. Here he is, the Victoria's rifle bird. He has chosen the best perch for his display, one that gets enough sunlight to enhance his iridescent sheen plumage. He does everything to be seen and heard by as many females as possible. Here's a female that seems interested. Now, it's showtime. Thank you. It's a good start, but the female expects more. The difference in plumage between the male and female Victoria's rifle bird is striking. That's true of all birds of paradise. The males spend their energy in extravagant plumage, or spectacular displays, or both. Females with their discreet outfit act as judges. They'll choose the best performing actor as their partner. Females can be hard on the males, but if they stay near the perch, then nothing is lost. This one hesitates a lot. She needs a second display before deciding. The suitor goes back on stage and performs again. He's done it. She's under his spell. The female has succumbed, but she knows the score. For birds of paradise, the charmer lures and copulates, that's all. Laying, incubating, feeding the hatchlings is a female's job. The male is only good for showing off. This behavior is only possible if the male has the right physical attributes and a certain talent in courting displays. Birds lacking these have invented other ways to court. One of them is at work. Here in the forest, at ground level. He's actually a gardening bird, known as the satin bower bird. As his plumage lacks brightness and sheen, he compensates with his prowess in landscaping. He's been working for several days on this bridal suite. Two parallel rows of twigs arched in the shape of an arbor. He now believes his work is complete, for he has just picked up a magnificent seed, an offering that should win over this female. Unfortunately, she didn't appreciate any of it. The male must make some improvements. This structure known as a bower is not intended as a nest. Once the male and female have mated, she will fly off and build a nest on her own. Rather, the bower acts as a bachelor pad for romantic encounters. Decoration is also very important. The satin bower bird has chosen a blue theme for his bachelor pad, a color that suits the sheen of his feathers and seems to appeal to females. Any objects he can find around will do, provided they are blue. This time it's perfect. It's just missing a female to come and approve the masterpiece and agree to mate with its builder under the arbor. This sophistication is not universal. At the other end of the spectrum is the kangaroo courtship. For them, the courting game can be summed up in one word: fighting. To demonstrate that you're a worthwhile sexual partner, you have to know how to box. As an aside, the females of the red kangaroo species are much grayer than the males. These kangaroos form groups of about 10 females led by a dominant male. He regularly must defend his supremacy against other males who are as keen to mate as he is. As with all kangaroo species, these Tasmanian kangaroos indulge in ritual fighting. Those fights are meant to reinforce the position of the dominant male, or instead enable the winning challenger to take over as leader. But things are not always as clear-cut. Even if the leader of the mob has reinforced his supremacy, it often happens that other males illegally claim the right to mate with females. As a result, the females have to suffer the continuous harassment by a string of offenders. The female kangaroo is much smaller than the male, so even if he is very keen, he must remember a golden rule. Handle the lady with care. Avoid manhandling the object of desire. Persevere without getting impatient. That's what this tenacious urge to pass on the male genes leads to. The chief of the mob is busy somewhere else. The males quickly take this opportunity to satisfy their instincts, but they must hurry, and unfortunately the females do not always cooperate. The one waiting his turn is torn between his eagerness to mate and the fear of being caught. What was meant to happen, happened. The master of the harem has caught a cheat. Boxing kangaroos comply with their own set of fairly strict rules. In particular, they forbid themselves from using their powerful hind legs and claws, which could disembowel an opponent. The dispute is settled. The dominant male remains in power. The challenger must now leave the ring until the next opportunity to oust him. A beach near Darwin in Australia's far north. They've waited for low tide to begin their musical display. They are fiddler crabs. And here is their audience, one female. She set the tone by her mere presence. The huge asymmetrical claw of these crabs has been compared to a violin or fiddle held by a musician on the side, hence the name fiddler crab. Only one female for so many candidates is bound to intensify rivalries. Instead of tuning into each other's violins, some of them are now crossing bows. The winner goes back to his burrow and feeds with the smallest claw. The other claw is too big for this meticulous work. Here is another species of fiddler crabs with a less glamorous claw. One female has responded to his charm, but she has not quite decided. Maybe she'll accept to come and visit his burrow. The problem is that he's not the only one with this proposal, and time is running out. The tide is coming in soon. Our male is out of luck. The female preferred to run into a burrow that's too small for him. Finally, she opted for mating outside. Each species of fiddler crab has its own courtship dance. Their steps and their movements are as varied as our rumba and waltz. Fiddler crabs love to live in colonies. They gather in dozens. However, they dig their own burrow at a respectful distance from each other. Sharing out territory does trigger conflicts. The owner of a burrow is always fighting off intruders trying to evict him. Even if the clash can be very tough, it never leads to serious injuries. After a duel, the fiddler crab should clean his weapon, as this instrument might be needed at any time for courtship. After mating, the female carries thousands of eggs attached to her abdominal legs. She'll release them in the sea to hatch. During that time, she'll ignore any claw-waving pantomime. Dancing is also enjoyed in the ocean. In summer, the giant cuttlefish gather in hundreds of thousands in this bay of southern Australia. A long procession of males must display their prowess under the discerning and stern eyes of a few females. The males have the ability to transform their bodies into a picture, alive with shadows and enchanting shimmers. The female will just ignore the candidate if he gets his color display wrong or botches his undulations. This male must have performed impeccably. He's just embraced his conquest. Reproduction tentacle into the pouch of his partner and to release his sperm. It's a bit more tricky when other males try to mate with the same female. During the scrum, each male impresses the others with numerous light effects or by expelling an ink jet. She managed to escape. This smaller, smart cuttlefish was just waiting for such an opportunity. Actually cheat to achieve their goal, changing their appearance to look like a female. This is not so difficult for them as they can change their body color and appearance at will. That female thought she was dealing with two girlfriends, only to find out that she's surrounded by two males who are fighting over her. Choices. She can either preserve the sperm of her previous mating partner, or mate with another who has to expel the sperm of the first one. It's an endless dance. Imagine a lover with no special physical characteristics nor dress uniform. Well, he can always use an aphrodisiac, like this red-browed finch. To seduce a lady, he waves a nesting symbol that gives a certain panache to his courtship dance. Stubbornly, the suitor starts again, this time with a strip of grass, another symbolic object. A cousin of the red-browed finch has turned up out of curiosity. It's a diamond firetail. But the females do not seem convinced. Feathers and twigs are the two materials used by the red-browed finch to build their nest. Hence the choice of these two instruments during the courtship display. elegantly hopping, skillfully handling the twig or feather, beautifully singing. So much talent is required to get a female's interest. And despite the best intentions, 9 times out of 10 gets rejected. There is far less frantic activity in the courtship of these parrots, the Rainbow Lorikeet. The couple is united for life, but cannot do without the group. Lorikeets feed all at the same time, gather at night in dormitory trees, and often perform their courtship in a chorus, even if their vows are only intended for their life partner. After ritually reaffirming their bond, they are welded to each other and remain inseparable. In addition to the splendid plumage of rainbow colors, the lorikeet has a wonderful vocal gift. Screeching, chattering, twittering, a very varied repertoire. More than 700 species of birds have been identified in Australia. The largest family is the one which includes cockatoos, parrots, and parakeets. This is one of the most graceful, hence its name, Elegant Parrot. Apart from the great central deserts, the lorikeets have conquered every habitat in Australia. Moors and heathers, eucalyptus forests, bushy savannas, tropical rainforests. They feed on fruits, berries, and seeds. They suck the pollen and nectar from flowers using the bristle-like papillae of their tongue. If there are no flowers, it's easy to drink from their partner's feathers. Pecking is also used to deposit saliva on each other, which transmits subtle messages to enhance the bond between them. As the breeding season progresses, the ties between partners strengthen. Together, they'll start to check out the trees in search of the ideal holes for a nest. Afterwards, the female incubates her eggs alone for 25 days. But I don't fly, and I incubate eggs without sitting on them. Who am I? A megapod. This specimen here is an Australian brush turkey, a male, easily recognized by his badly ironed yellow scarf around his neck, known as a wattle. Breeding season obliges. He's busy building up the nest using leaves, twigs, and moss. He has to build a mound 1 meter high and 3 meters in diameter. In fact, brush turkey eggs are only incubated by the heat of rotten vegetation. Neither the male nor the female incubate the eggs. Each day, the male comes to change this compost of leaves, making sure it is aired and soaked from the rain, bringing new vegetable material to maintain a constant heat production in his nest. Several females are invited to lay a dozen eggs each in different niches within the mound. In the meantime, the male is working hard to perfect his incubator. Like cows in our meadows, kangaroos spend long hours grazing and chewing the cud. From dusk onwards, the group disperses around a clearing where they will graze all night long. The group, the community, means a lot for these marsupials. They're gregarious. They enjoy warm contacts, being together for everything. The young ones are constantly in their mother's pouch, to suckle obviously, but also to be made a fuss of. It's got to be said that they had a difficult start in life. When the baby is born, after only 33 days of gestation, it's still an embryo. Eyes and ears are barely developed. Back legs are mere stumps, and yet an extremely tough test awaits. Crawling up the mother's abdomen, clinging onto her fur, to climb into the pouch. There, the baby attaches itself to one of the four teats, and as it suckles, will develop into a perfect kangaroo. 6 months later, he ventures outside the pouch, but it still takes 2 or 3 months to become an independent kangaroo, known as a joey in Australia. Its true freedom and independence is clear when it begins to box, for fun, with a brother or cousin. Of milk. When it is newborn, clinging to her teat, it drinks a sugar-rich milk. Once outside, it will suck, by sticking its head inside the pouch, a much fatter milk, better adapted to its energy needs. Getting into this pouch, which acts as a pantry, shelter, transport, and balcony with view onto the world, is almost an addiction among young kangaroos. Long after leaving, the joey takes every opportunity to snuggle in again for a rest, even if he's too old for that. That's the ideal position, after much contortion and wriggling to get there. Rest time is partially devoted to grooming, which is very much a personal affair. Mutual help and grooming, which are so important for other animal communities such as monkeys, is not the done thing for kangaroos. The four legs with their five claws are an ideal comb. Only the length of the arm is not up to scratch. There is no social grooming, but instead all sorts of hugs and kisses. Kangaroos from an early age get used to such physical contact, which they will repeat later on in their friendships. This bird specializes in plagiarism. It's an Australasian fig bird, the Australian cousin of our oriole. Males display together, but the term display is too strong. They just sing, each trying to be louder than the other. Their serenade is made by mimicking other birds to build up their repertoire. It may very well change from one season to another. A clever way to seduce when you are neither a dancer nor an acrobat. The Australasian fig bird feeds on fruits without being fanatical. They occasionally enjoy small insects and nectar from flowers. They are commonly known as galahs. There are several million of them covering all the regions of Australia, apart from the most arid desert areas. Their real name is the rose-breasted cockatoo, because their chests are pink, hemmed with white. They travel in huge flocks according to a strict timetable from dawn to dusk. Their goal, their obsession, is to find water. Sometimes the urge to drink is just as strong for kangaroos, despite their relative temperance. However, these two are hurrying for something else. From far away, they smell the pasture of fresh grass, which they really fancy. As luck would have it, there is a billabong nearby. While some birds living in this arid environment are able to spend 2 to 3 days without drinking, crested pigeons must quench their thirst every day. Every day, they're also in the mood to perform their courtship shows. These perches are used by both cooing pigeons and bantering bluebonnets. Bright or pastel colors, moiré or iridescent effects, delicate shades. All the genius of an artist can be seen in the plumage of parrots. As long as there is enough grass to graze, red kangaroos thrive. Indeed, they only breed if the vegetation is abundant. When there isn't enough, during droughts, the females cannot conceive. A very simple birth control system. A dozen kangaroos have joined those who discovered the beautiful green pasture. But the escapade is coming to an end. Dusk is falling, and the kangaroos will join the rest of the mob to graze together in their usual clearings. Each one will stop at the billabong on the way back for a last drink. Saurus cranes have spent their day in the bush or in farmed fields pecking seeds and insects. They're now returning to the edge of a marsh to rest for the night. In India, where they live in large numbers, it is said that Saurus cranes were the inspiration for the epic Ramayana poem, which goes, "Cranes flying in single lines to the delight of the clouds look like a garland of lotus flowers pushed by the wind." Australia has experienced a turbulent geological history, isolated for 40 million years, with countless changes in its climate, hence the diversity of its landscape and unique fauna. The Aborigines, the original inhabitants of Australia, have a much more poetic way to explain the creation of their land. A powerful god heaped up the mountains on the surface of the island and carved out the riverbeds. They call him the Rainbow Snake. There is only one country in the world where you can see these silhouettes. Australia has chosen as its emblem a very distinctive animal. It's the largest marsupial, the well-known kangaroo. Just a note, however, out of the 60 different species of kangaroos, we will mainly follow the most common one, the red kangaroo. It's easy to understand the amazement of the first explorers when they discovered this creature. A greyhound leaping like a deer or a desert rat, but much bigger, is how James Cook described a kangaroo when he landed on this unknown continent. This creature could come straight out of a medieval book of fantastic beasts, with its huge hind, puny chest, short arms, rabbit-like head, and a tail over a meter long, which is either used as a prop or as a balance. Kangaroos hop at an average speed of 20 to 25 kilometers per hour, 40 kilometers per hour at top speed, even at 60 over short distances. We are in the arid bush of southern Australia, where temperatures exceed 40 degrees Celsius during the dry season. The red kangaroo has become fully adapted to this environment. Is he feeling too hot? He moistens his forearms by licking them. As the saliva evaporates, the body cools down. Kangaroos can go without drinking for some time, as the plants they eat contain 20 to 30% water. But if he smells there's a pool nearby, he will go off track to find it. These water pools, known as billabongs, retain water during the dry season. They are a heaven-sent oasis for the animals living in the bush. Kangaroos often have to put up with noisy neighbors, the little corellas. Corellas love to form large flocks and are very gregarious. At dawn, they settle on a perch which is ideally located for drinking. This young kangaroo has returned to his mother. At two, he is still timid and probably frightened by the noisy baying cockatoos. Male female corellas are strictly identical. The couples pair for life, and once they focus on their nesting site, they'll stay away from large crowds. Only the immature youngsters keep flying in groups until they find their soulmate. Dawn has made way for full daylight. Kangaroos go back to their moms. Those cranes are like hurrying silhouettes in the sky. This tropical species, the saurus crane, is so elegant with its extraordinary 2.4-meter wingspan. With such a wing surface, the crane can fly at nearly 80 kilometers per hour. It means it would only take them a few days to cover the 3,000 kilometers that separate the arid south from the lush rainforests of Queensland in Western Australia. An artist is about to enter this emerald setting. Here he is. The victorious rifle bird. He has chosen the best perch for his display, one that gets enough sunlight to enhance his iridescent sheen plumage. He does everything to be seen and heard by as many females as possible. Here's a female that seems interested. Now, it's showtime. It's a good start, but the female expects more. The difference in plumage between the male and female Victoria's rifle bird is striking. That's true of all birds of paradise. The males spend their energy in extravagant plumage, or spectacular displays, or both. Females with their discreet outfit act as judges. They'll choose the best performing actor as their partner. Females can be hard on the males, but if they stay near the perch, then nothing is lost. This one hesitates a lot. She needs a second display before deciding. The suitor goes back on stage and performs again. He's done it. She's under his spell. The female has succumbed, but she knows the score. For birds of paradise, the charmer lures and copulates, that's all. Laying, incubating, feeding the hatchlings is a female's job. The male is only good for showing off. This behavior is only possible if the male has the right physical attributes and a certain talent in courting displays. Birds lacking these have invented other ways to court. One of them is at work. Here in the forest, at ground level. He's actually a gardening bird known as the Satin Bower Bird. As his plumage lacks brightness and sheen, he compensates with his prowess in landscaping. He's been working for several days on this bridal suite. Two parallel rows of twigs arched in the shape of an arbor. He now believes his work is complete, for he has just picked up a magnificent seed, an offering that should win over this female. Unfortunately, she didn't appreciate any of it. The male must make some improvements. This structure known as a bower is not intended as a nest. Once the male and female have mated, she will fly off and build a nest on her own. Rather, the bower acts as a bachelor pad.